things. All right, let's see. We're gonna start in like 6 minutes. All right, hello. Gonna start in like 4 minutes, 5 minutes rather, if we want to be exact. I'm just trying to figure out how I can see. I can see the comments, but I can't see who is watching. Let's see. No, that's not it. So if you guys want to do a watch party, you're welcome to do that as well. So all of your friends can see as well. The more people we have watching, the better it'll be. Okay, and if you're in the comments, we can see you if you do say something, so. Got 2 more minutes. Give everybody a chance to get on. Hey, Lyndon. More New Jersey people, that's good. All right, one more minute and we'll get started. Gonna be in time this time. All right, it's 4 o'clock exactly. So let's get started. All right, so let's see here. So first of all, we have a winner for the contest last time, and that was Cyacel, I believe. She won the T-Rex contest, so congratulations. You're gonna get the yeah, something is chirping. They're crickets. I have a bunch of crickets in this room because I feed them to my pets. I have a bunch of reptiles and stuff in here. But anyway, so she won, so she's gonna get 4 tickets, family 4-pack to Field Station Dinosaurs in New Jersey. So that's exciting. All right, and then last time, while I was drawing, a lot of people were suggesting dinosaurs they wanted to see for next time. One of them was Connor, and he wanted to see a Parasaurolophus, and he's not the only one. There's actually a couple other people who wanted Parasaurolophus. So it was between Parasaurolophus and Baryonyx, and it was really close. It was like 50%, 50-50 split in the votes. Then there was a while where Baryonyx was in the lead, but in the end, Parasaurolophus won out. So we're going to do Parasaurolophus today. If you don't know about Parasaurolophus, that's okay. But I think most of us do know this dinosaur. It's a fairly popular dinosaur. It's not as popular as maybe T-Rex or Triceratops or Velociraptor, but it's definitely up there. It's a plant-eating dinosaur. It's a member of the duck-billed dinosaur group. We call them duck-billed dinosaurs because their skull, the front part of their skull where their mouth was, had a beak. Excuse me, and the skull had like a wide, flat beak. We actually know they didn't look really much like a duck at all. We'll get into that when I start drawing it. But they have this unofficial common name as the duck-billed dinosaurs. We also call them the hadrosaurs, which is the more scientific term for the group. And Parasaurolophus is probably out of the group of them, probably the most well-recognized hadrosaur. And the reason why is because it had this really interesting crest sticking out of the back of its head. The crest was made of bone, okay, so this wasn't just skin or anything like that. It was actually part of the skull, and the crest itself was hollow, and it was attached to the animal's nasal passages. So we don't know what exactly it was doing with its crest, but the leading idea is that Parasaurolophus probably used this to help make sounds. So Parasaurolophus would have inhaled air, and the air before it left would have gone through this crest, kind of like a wind instrument. It's often compared to a trombone, and that would have helped make like a neat, like loud sound, kind of like frogs and a lot of birds do today. So that's pretty cool all on its own. And we don't know why they would have done this. It's probably something related to display within the same species. Some ideas out there that the male Parasaurolophus had a longer crest than the females. That's entirely possible. There are different Parasaurolophus skeletons on the fossil record, and some of them have a shorter crest. I believe those are from Western, I want to say New Mexico, the ones with the short crests. But as of now, I think they're considered a different species. There's, I think, 3 different species of Parasaurolophus. The one with the big long crest that most people know is Parasaurolophus wallkeri. So that's what we're going to do today. All right, cool. So I have my paper propped up here this time, And let's see. Yeah, and I am, guys, just as a reminder, I can see the comments. So if I don't respond, it's not because I'm not trying to ignore anybody. I just very well might not see it. But I will try to respond to comments, especially questions if I see them. So yeah, let's get started with our Parasaurolophus. All right, so I have my model here. So let's get started. I'm going to try to sketch it out propped up first. Hopefully maybe that works better. I got a little bit of feedback last time. Some people said that they wanted to see if there's a way I could draw propped up so I wouldn't have to keep like lifting the paper up. Let's do this. All right. So Parasaurolophus, let's start with the head. As I told you last time, I prefer to start with the head. This dinosaur, let's see. I'm gonna draw like a circle up here, kind of for the area where the eye is gonna be. They had a snout that came down. The eye is gonna go about there. Lower jaw, yeah. And then, so if you look, I'll draw the eye is gonna start here. The mouth is gonna be here. The lower jaw is gonna be here. Let me erase that a little bit. There's some squiggly lines. That's okay when you're sketching. And then the crest, that really noticeable trademark crest this dinosaur is actually going to be connected directly to the snout. So I'm going to make that crest go all the way back. Going to end about there. And the back of our head's going to be there. Okay, now with regards to the snout. As it turns out, hadrosaurs, their beaks were a lot longer than what the skeleton usually shows. And that makes sense. Just like with a lot of birds, especially in turtles, a lot of animals alive today with beaks, there's a layer of material on the outside of the beak called keratin, which is the same material as your fingernails are made of. So that would have extended the beak beyond what the skull shows you. Most of the time in dinosaur skeletons, we just have the bones, the skulls, but occasionally they will fossilize the keratin, and we actually have a few hadrosaurs with the keratin still in the beak, and it turns out that their beak was a bit longer and more downturned. So it wasn't really like a duck. It actually would have looked more like an upside down shovel. And it probably would have had an extreme overbite. So I'm going to make that beak extend down further, like that. And then I'm going to do the lower jaw here. The back of the jaw is going to stand up, and then the ear is going to go right there. And then I'm going to give my Parasaurolophus some nostrils. The nostril holes were about here, so I'm going to put them right there. Great. Now the back of the head. Parasaurolophus had like an S-shaped neck. Pretty much all hadrosaurs did. So the neck is kind of going to go dip down. Or I shouldn't say S, more of like a U-shaped neck. Most dinosaurs had a somewhat S-shaped neck, but the way hadrosaurs kind of held their heads was on the end of a relatively long neck, and it kind of dipped down, and then it went back up. Now that line that I just drew, it's kind of meant to mimic where the spinal cord would be. And the actual flesh of the neck would be extended past that. So the top of the neck is going to be here, and the bottom of the neck would be here. But that's just the meat of the neck. Okay. Let's see. Okay, so there's that. So I'm actually going to erase this inside now that I've made the meat of my neck. Where all the flesh and the muscles and the skin would be. And as it turns out, hadrosaurs actually had even thicker necks than that. We actually have some hadrosaur mummies in the fossil record. So by mummy, I don't mean like, a guy wrapped up in cloth in a sarcophagus like from Egypt. There's natural mummies too with animals, especially including dinosaurs. So that's when a dinosaur died under really unusual circumstances so that the skin and a lot of other soft tissues preserved as well. So what it shows us is that hadrosaurs actually had thicker necks than we thought. They're actually kind of remind me a little bit of like the neck of a horse. So if you think about a horse's neck, horses have these big thick, powerful necks, but their skeleton isn't doesn't reflect that. So hadrosaurs would have been the same. So my Parasaurolophus's neck is a bit thicker there. Now, onto the body. The basic outline of the body is going to be this torso. That's going to be like where the rib cage is. And then it's going to go down. So some hips. And then the tail. Hadrosaur tails are really long. The tail is going to extend back there. And the vertebra of a hadrosaur, so the backbone would have been right along here. Okay? The vertebra of hadrosaurs were actually pretty tall, and they had these parts on the top of the vertebrae called neural arches. And neural arches, we have neural arches too. If you take your hand and you run your finger down your back, you can feel these little bumps. Those are called neural arches. We have them as well. Some dinosaurs made their neural arches, evolved their neural arches really, really tall. Spinosaurus is the most famous one that did that. Some of Spinosaurus's neural arches were like 6 feet tall. But Hadrosaurs had this too. It wasn't as big as a Spinosaurus, but they did have raised neural arches, and it would have made it look like they had like kind of a hump on their back. So I'm actually going to extend Parasaurolophus's back a bit more, like that. All right, so now we have our torso, we have our tail, looking pretty good. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to start doing the limbs. So the shoulders started up here. We have the same thing, our shoulder blades called a scapula. And then the chest would have been down here. And then there's the upper arm. And then there's the, now note, I'm just doing little sticks. I'm just drawing little lines here. It's nothing crazy. The lower arm. And then the hand. Now, remember last week we drew the T-Rex and I told you about dinosaur feet. Okay, and how they walk on their toes. Well, in the front limbs, it would have been the same thing. Now, T-Rex didn't walk on its hands, but hadrosaurs did. They could have, at least. So the way they would have walked if they were walking on all fours, and my model is doing it too, okay, is you can see, let's see, I'll actually use the paper here. Okay, the wrist was actually higher up. So it's not like when people think, whoop, oh no, it fell over. When people think, oh, I'm gonna walk on, all fours, you think about putting your hand flat on the surface. And some animals on all fours do walk that way, like alligators and lizards and even mice will do that. But dinosaurs and a lot of other animals actually walk on their fingers like this. Okay, and duck-billed dinosaurs specifically had hands that were not really like ours. They, first of all, they had fewer digits. Whoop, fell over again. So I'll actually put this down here for now. So they had three toes that they kind of essentially used for walking. So there's one big toe in the middle, or finger, I should say, that kind of was like a hoof. And there was a big claw there that was kind of rounded in the front. And it would have functioned a lot like a hoof. Okay, so we're going to draw that from the side. So first thing I'm going to do is, so we're going to flesh out this arm here. So we're going to make the arm a little thicker because remember, it had to support a lot of weight here. It's an elbow. And there's the wrist. That's going to be our wrist. And then on the bottom, I'm drawing the one big hoof there. And there's like another finger that kind of stuck out to the side. So you can see there's the one hoof sticking out of the bottom, and there's a kind of finger sticking out to the side a little bit. And then we have kind of a belly's going to hang down a little bit. Plant-eating dinosaurs especially would have had big round bellies. I don't, just the way it is. A lot of plant-eating animals alive today have big bellies. I think of a cow or even a horse, okay? And the reason why they have big stomach cavities is because plants are difficult to digest. They are, it's true. Plants are more difficult to digest for your body than meat is. If you think about it, we're already made of meat, right? We're animals. Animals are made of meat. So if you're eating meat, it's easier for your body to take meat and break it down and use it to, fuel your body as is. If you're eating plants, your body has to work a little bit harder to break down those plants and get the nutrients out of them.
So animals that eat exclusively plants or almost exclusively plants, they need to have big, powerful stomachs to process these plants, especially if they're eating plants like pine needles, okay, which we know hadrosaurs ate because we actually have gut contents from hadrosaurs fossilized. So we actually know for a fact that they were eating like pine needles and stuff in the wild, which is not a very nutritious food if you think about it. We eat plants, but the plants that we eat are at least like really, as far as plants go, easy to eat. Vegetables and fruits and things like that. Well, these guys are eating leaves and pine needles, which are like a kind of leaf, which are not very nutritious. So they'd have to eat a lot of them, A, and their body had to work really hard to digest them. So they would have had really big, wide stomachs to help digest that food, to ferment it. If you ever hear people say cows have four stomachs, that's kind of what they're talking about. Cows don't actually have four stomachs, by the way. They have one stomach that's segmented into four chambers. So it has four sections within its stomach where the food goes through in order to digest. Okay. So plant-eating dinosaurs like hadrosaurs would have had to digest food a lot as well because plants are hard to get. And also, by the way, if food is hard to digest, that also means there's a lot of waste product and byproduct. And your body produces a lot of gas in response to digesting these plants. That's why if you eat like a lot of vegetables like broccoli or cabbage or Brussels sprouts, you fart afterwards. I said fart or toot. I think fart's okay to say. Fart, it's a fun word. Well, these plant-eating dinosaurs would have been farting a lot, probably. Okay, if you ever go to a farm and see the cows and the horses, cows especially, they are farting machines. So a dinosaur like this hadrosaur, as cool as it looks, probably would have been a little stinky to be around, just saying. But anyway. So we're giving this guy a belly on the bottom where all that plant material would be digesting. And then we're going to start with the leg. Now these guys had big, powerful legs, kind of like the T-Rex that we did last time. And that's because, like T-Rex, they also, even though they could walk around on all fours, hadrosaurs could get up on their hind legs and walk on their hind legs and run on their hind legs too. In fact, if they wanted to go faster, they probably would rear up on their hind legs and run on too. So we're going to give it a big thick calf there. Now remember, they have all the same joints that we do in their legs. They don't have backwards knees. So here's the knee here. This is the thigh. This is the calf. This is going to be the ankle joint. Going to make sure that it's level with my front leg. Okay. Then this is going to be the foot. And these are going to be the toes. Now, since they were walking on their toes a lot, they probably had a big toe pad there. Okay, so there would have been like a big section of fleshy skin, tough fleshy skin, that would have been like for cushioning, kind of like the pads on the bottom of a dog's or a cat feet, cat's foot. And then we're going to do the toenails. Now, remember, I told you with the T-Rex, and these guys would have been the same, the toenails would not have been very sharp because they would have been walking around on them all the time. All right, and then we have our foot. I'm actually going to lower the belly even more. There we go. I'll erase that. There we go. Cool. It's okay if while you're doing artwork you want to change it and erase it. That's fine. Everybody makes mistakes, right? So I lowered the belly so it looks a little better there. Now we're going to go into the tail. Now, just like the T-Rex, there would have been a big muscle that attached the leg to the tail. So there wouldn't have been much definition for the back of the leg. It kind of would have just went right into the tail. And the tail and hadrosaurs were thick. So it's going to go all the way down. Almost to the end of my paper. Okay, cool. There we go. Looking good. I kind of did it off center. Yeah, see, sometimes when you start a drawing, you think it's going to be all centered in, and then it turns into something else. I didn't really mean to do it in the side profile, but it just worked out this way. So I might trim it later to make it look nicer, but that's okay. So we have our profile, but something's missing. Oh, I know. It's missing two of its limbs. So that's not good. We can't have just a two-limbed dinosaur here. Cool. So let's do the other limbs. All right, so here's a little tip. If you're drawing an animal, especially if it has four legs, and maybe it's walking, Okay, or maybe it's not walking. Very rarely will animals stand with their right and left side completely symmetrical. There's usually one foot in front of the other. So I'm actually going to make the arm that's away from us a little bit behind Parasaurolophus, the other leg. There we go. And we actually know, and now from this angle, you can actually see the other finger. So here's the big hoof-like finger, and then there's actually another claw here. And we actually know that they had that thanks to some mummified remains that preserve the claws. I'm going to thicken that up a little bit because this is a big, heavy animal, needed to have big, powerful front arms to support all that weight. I think a lot of times some reconstructions of hadrosaurs by accident have really skinny front legs. They probably didn't. All right. And then our foot, here's the little tip I was telling you about. Now, you have a choice now, right? You could make the back foot, the foot that's away from us, in front or behind. What do you think it's going to be? Well, if you want to make it more realistic, put it in front. If your front limb is going to be behind, your back limb should be in front. It wouldn't be, if I put the leg back here, that wouldn't be very realistic looking. Okay. So let's take our back leg and put that here. Because animals don't walk like that. They don't walk. You ever watch an animal walk? Literally watch any animal on all fours walk around. Like if you have a pet dog or a cat or even a hamster, okay? Not a rabbit, not a bunny rabbit because they hop, okay? But any animal that walks, if you go outside and you see someone walking their dog or even a deer, maybe if you live by the woods, you'll watch the way they walk. They don't walk like two and two. Okay. In fact, some animals like cats, when they lift up their front leg, the back leg actually goes exactly where the front leg was. It goes right into the paw print that was left behind. So just something to keep in mind that maybe you might not have noticed before. And remember, some people, might wonder, hey, you talk a lot about live animals, but this is about dinosaurs, right? But if you think about it, dinosaurs were animals too, right? Some people forget that. Like it sounds silly right now, but you got to remember dinosaurs, or I should say extinct dinosaurs, right? Because birds are dinosaurs. Dinosaurs were animals. That's all there is to it. They weren't, mythical creatures. They weren't like dragons. They weren't like fantasy monsters or anything, although sometimes pop culture makes them like that. But at the end of the day, they were just animals, just like animals are today. And a lot of the rules that animals have about their biology and the way they behave would have applied to extinct dinosaurs too. So a lot of times when I'm doing artwork, I think about living animals while I'm making the art, and it makes the art even cooler. Cool. So we have our basic like design down for Parasaurolophus. But we can add some more stuff to it. So this is like our basic body plan, right? But let's make it a little bit more interesting. So the crest, right? The crest here is made of bone underneath. But, and we could leave it like this if we wanted to. But I'm going to add something to it. So in life, when Parasaurolophus was alive, this crest probably had something to do with display or communication within species. So, what if there was something a little extra on there to make it look even more impressive to members of its own species? Maybe a rival or a potential mate? And I'm not the first one to think this. Some artists have reconstructed their Parasaurolophus with like a flap of skin that goes from the crest down to the base of the neck, kind of like a sailboat. Okay. And more recently, we actually have some pieces of skin that were mummified that are on a Parasaurolophus crest on the sides. Now that skin doesn't tell us too much. All it tells us essentially is that there was skin there, but I think everyone could have assumed that. It's still cool because we know what the little scales kind of look like, but I don't think you I think you could have guessed even without that that there was skin there. So, but because that some artists have actually made like there's two like flaps sticking out of the side of the crest, we don't know. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually make like a wrinkly like sail of skin that's going to connect from this crest, and it's going to bunch up in here, and it's going to connect to the top of the back. Now, when I draw this, I'm going to make it really wrinkly. If I just kind of made like I'm going to draw it lightly, like a tight piece of skin, like it's stretched out, that wouldn't work too well, or it probably wouldn't work too well. Because if you think about it, there's a tightly stretched piece of skin there. That's going to have to be really stretchy, because otherwise Parasaurolophus wouldn't be able to turn its head from side to side. It would kind of be stuck like this, and that doesn't do the animal any good. So I'm going to make a lot of loose folds and extra skin that's going to kind of drape down to the sides. So even though it has this flap of skin for extra display, the animal can still move its head around. Now, keep in mind, again, this isn't a fact. We don't know for sure that this was there, but we don't know it wasn't. And sometimes when you're reconstructing dinosaurs, that's a cool thing to do. As long as it's logical and as long as you can kind of make a case for it, a lot of the stuff is okay to do here. So that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to start by kind of making, I'm not going to make it a straight, smooth line. I'm going to kind of make it like kind of wrinkly and kind of like some teardrop shapes down here. And I'm actually going to erase this line here. There we go. That way it's like kind of part of it now. There we go. So there's more wrinkles in there. There we go. Okay. And that is like our piece of skin. I'll move it even closer to the camera so you can see. So now our Parasaurolophus has like this really cool display adaptation in addition to that crest. I can do more too. What if on the bottom, and they're like we said, we know for a fact that they had thick necks. We also know that the skin around the neck would have been very wrinkly. They would have had some bunched up skin here. And again, this is all thanks to hadrosaur mummies, not Parasaurolophus itself, but other kinds of duck-billed dinosaurs. So it's likely it was a similar situation here. So there was a lot of folded, wrinkly skin around here. And what if underneath its chin it had some, maybe like a flap of skin, like a lot of lizards do. Think of like an iguana. Okay, that would have been neat too. So let's give it a little bit of a, we call it a dewlap. Now, if you don't want to do that, you don't have to. You can keep it like plain if you want. That's fine. But I'm just going to add that in. Like I told you about the T-Rex with regards to the feathers and stuff. With a lot of dinosaurs, there's more than one way to do it that are all correct, right? So this is what I'm talking about here. Maybe some of you guys, when you're done with your picture, you'll post it and it won't have those things. And that's cool. That's fine. That's still totally accurate and correct. But I'm doing that for fun. All right, cool. So, and here's our beak. I'm going to accentuate our beak a little bit here, outline it again. In the mouth, there would have been like, not really like a cheek per se. The mouth would have ended about there. But Parasaurolophus did have teeth. Don't be fooled. Just because an animal is a plant eater doesn't mean it didn't have teeth. I know last time we drew a lot of T-Rex teeth. This dinosaur has its mouth closed. And even if it did open its mouth, you probably wouldn't be able to see the teeth at all. Duck-billed dinosaurs or hadrosaurs had very small teeth. I actually have a duck-billed dinosaur tooth right here with me today. Whoop, there it is. See how small it is next to my thumb? That is one hadrosaur tooth. It's probably from an Edmontosaurus, but Parasaurolophus' teeth would have been the same. Now, even though that tooth is very small, it still was really good at processing plants. And the way hadrosaurs did that was by having a lot of teeth in their mouth. So they actually had like hundreds. We're talking like 500 teeth in their mouth. So they imagine those little teeth all packed together in like a bunch, like a block. And we call those dental batteries. So a hadrosaur would actually use that chunk of teeth like we would use our molars, or like a horse or a cow uses its molars. So instead of having a few large, big, blocky teeth in the back of their mouth, they would have hundreds of tiny teeth pressed together, working as a team to grind and shred up their food. Okay, or process their food, I should say, not necessarily grind. And that actually is a good adaptation, because what that means is if any of those teeth fell out, and they did fall out, in fact, the most common kind of dinosaur fossil that we find are teeth. That's okay, because they'll grow a new one. Dinosaurs, like pretty much all reptiles that have teeth, they're not like us where they just have baby teeth and then adult teeth, and that's it. Like, I have my adult teeth. If one of my teeth fell out, that's it. I'm not growing it back. I'd have to go to the dentist and maybe they put in like a fake tooth or something. But that's not an issue for dinosaurs. If a dinosaur is an adult and it lost a tooth, it would still grow a tooth right back. And if it lost that tooth, it would grow another tooth back. They could pretty much keep growing teeth back as much as they needed to. So that's great because if a hadrosaur dinosaur is crunching up all those plants all the time, the teeth are falling out constantly, and that's okay. They'll just keep growing back. Whereas nowadays, mammals that have big molars that do the same thing, if one of their teeth falls out, it's very painful and they might have a problem eating. An example of this is elephants. Elephants can live for a really long time, close to 100 years. The reason why a lot of elephants actually die in the wild is because their teeth wear out. And sometimes their teeth wear out or they rot, and then the animal can't eat, and then it usually dies because of that. Whereas a dinosaur wouldn't have that problem. Okay, so being a reptile and having teeth that can fall out and grow back is a pretty cool adaptation, especially if you're eating a lot of plants. All right, so there's our Hadrosaurus. I think it's ready for some color. Yeah, so let's start painting it. Now, for the painting section, since I do my paints in watercolors, I cannot have it up on this easel thing anymore because the watercolors are going to drip down. So I'm going to put my paper flat, just like when we did the T-Rex. All right, so paper is going to be flat. And then I'm going to angle the camera down so you can see it better. I'm going to put this over here. All right. Going to get my paints like last time. If you weren't here last time, these are watercolor paints, and you can see the watercolors are dry. Okay. And that's good. Watercolor is not like other paint where if it dries out, you can't use it. In fact, watercolor, it's great if it's dried out because then you can keep using it. It's activated when it gets wet. So I some of these watercolors I splurted on there with, I made up a word. I squeezed on there out of the tube like literally years ago. And they're still good. I'll replenish it and then I'll let it dry overnight. And then I just take a wet brush and I just kind of move it around in there and I get some paint. Here's my jug of water. My jug of water, that's also many years old. I've had that since I was like nine, the same jug of water. And here's my paints, my paint brushes rather, my Triceratops mug. This is from the Lost World Jurassic Park toy franchise mug from 1998. All right, cool. All righty, so I got my brushes, I got my water, I got my paints, got my paper, my camera is on the drawing. All right, let's start. Now, again, just like with the T-Rex, we know the colors of a few kinds of dinosaurs. Not Parasaurolophus, though. So it's kind of fair game. But at the same time, I want to be realistic about these colors, too. I want it to be believable. But since it has that big display going on in the face region and the head, maybe we can put some bright colors on there. Maybe this is like a male Parasaurolophus and he wants to impress a mate. And a lot of times, animals today will have bright, flashy colors if it means that they can impress a potential mate. Even if those bright, flashy colors, I'm erasing some excess lines right now, even if it means that they don't camouflage as well. So even if, like, say, like a peacock, everyone knows peacocks have bright, flashy colors. Not everyone knows that the females, which would not be called a peacock, they call a peahen, okay, do not look very much like the males at all. They have a little bit of color on them. They have like some greenish on the head, but they're not nearly as beautiful and bright as the male is. Well, I guess beautiful could be objective, but they're not as bright and flashy as the male, that's for sure. And they blend in a lot better. When it comes to avoiding predators like leopards or tigers where they live in India, the females are a lot safer than the males. They don't get eaten by leopards as much, whereas males, the peacocks, actually get eaten by leopards a lot. And that's because they're bright colors. However, some males survive, and they survive long enough to impress a mate, and that's important to them. So even though Parasaurolophus would have had predators to worry about, like some tyrannosaurs, not Tyrannosaurus rex, but maybe some other kinds of tyrannosaurs, like I think Despletosaurus was around at the same time and place as Parasaurolophus, which is a smaller tyrannosaurid. Not that much smaller, like 30 feet. Still pretty big. It still would have been willing, maybe, to have some bright colors on the head. So I know that a couple people watching really like this dinosaur. I know Lyndon likes this dinosaur a lot. I know Audrey really likes Parasaurolophus a lot. She has a Parasaurolophus stuffed animal that I gave her as a present. And Audrey's stuffed animal Parasaurolophus is red. And I believe Lyndon likes the color red as well, if I'm not mistaken. So let's use some red on this dinosaur. I think that's a good idea. All right, cool. So it's going to put draw redraw the hips there. Okay. I'm going to make it red on the face, and then I'm going to kind of blend the red into like a brownish gray. All right, so let's start with the front. Now, the first wash of paint is going to be kind of messy, but that's okay. So I'm going into my red. I have two shades of red. I have a pinkish red, and I have a more slightly orangier red. And I'm going to mix them together, but I'm going to do mostly the pinkish red. All right. And then I'm going to start here. Do the tip of the nose. You can see I'm putting some paint on the nose there. Okay. Now I'm going around the eye. I'm actually going to paint over the beak, even though I'm going to make the beak a different color later on. But I'm going to paint over the red. That's okay. I'm willing to paint over that a little bit. And I'm going to make sure a lot of that pretty red gets on that sail I gave the Parasaurolophus in the back. Remember, the sail isn't really based on any factual evidence, but it could have been there. All right. I'm going to put a little bit of red on the bottom. More like pink right now. All right. In fact, this color scheme, I didn't really think of it this way, but it's very similar to an animal that's alive today. There's a dinosaur alive today, so a bird, that has the color scheme that I'm actually doing. It's a little bird. It lives around here, where I live in Maryland. And you can also find it pretty much all around on the East Coast, on the Northeast Coast at the very least. I remember seeing them when I was in Philadelphia. And they start to come out just around this time of year. It's called a house finch. Maybe you've seen them at a bird feeder, or you know, they're not really a rare bird. They like to live around where there's people. When I was in Philadelphia, there was actually one that used to like to hang out by the Wawa in downtown Philadelphia, right by the Art Museum. Used to sit on the telephone wire and sing its little heart out. And here in Maryland, there's some that come to my feeder as well. So house finches are a little bird, little songbird, and they're mostly brown, but the males have a bright reddish pink face. And that's kind of exactly what I'm doing with this Parasaurolophus. I didn't even think of that, but kind of like that, how it worked out that way. We're doing right at the beginning of springtime. And the birds are starting a lot, well, not all the birds, but a lot of the birds are starting to come back. Some of the birds never left, but house finches are coming back, and the males are showing up, and they have that bright reddish pink on the face and the grayish brown body. So now I'm going into the gray and brown if you can't see. So I'm making like a brownish gray by mixing red and green together with a little bit of blue to make this pretty grayish blue color. I'm sorry, grayish brown color. A lot of people don't realize that dull colors can be pretty too. When you think of pretty colors, a lot of people think of bright, flashy colors. But I think there's something to be said about like browns and grays. They can be beautiful as well. All right, gonna move on to the legs. Foot. Remember, this is just a simple wash. And if you're at home, maybe you don't have watercolors, maybe you could do the same thing. You could start coloring in crayons or colored pencils or markers or whatever you have available. Or maybe you don't want to color it. That's okay too. You could just do a nice pencil sketch. Or maybe you have pens. Maybe you're working with pens. You do like an ink drawing. That's a totally valid medium. Take a ballpoint pen, even. All right, the tail is actually going to end up being a slightly different color because I mixed this shade with a little bit of orange. It's going to be a little bit more orangey brown looking. All right. Now, while the paint is still wet, I'm actually going to go back like a smaller brush. Let me find a smaller brush. Here we go. With this red color. Mix it with a little bit of black to make it a little darker. I'm gonna go in and I'm gonna make like some cool designs in the face and let it bleed in. And this will turn to something later. Like a darker brown. And while the paint's still wet, I'm gonna draw some stripes, kind of going down the back. Maybe one on the top of the back here. This doesn't look like much right now, but when it dries out, it'll look a lot nicer. All right, and then before the paint drips, here's what I have so far. So it has like a bright pinkish red head and like a grayish brown body. Okay, so we're gonna let that paint dry. Then when it dries, we'll start our next coat. I think while we're waiting for it to dry, maybe we can do some of the background. So let's do that. Yeah, so let's go to the bottom. Let's start some background color. So let's do the ground first. So I'm gonna do some like brown. Whoop, it's a lot of red. Some brown. This is a more reddish brown, so it's not the exact. Oh, that's more greenish, huh? It's very greenish. All right, well, maybe there's like a patch of moss there or something. There we go. Okay, so I have like a greenish brownish ground. That's cool. And I'm not going too crazy. I'm not too concerned with getting it perfect, right? Can I go in beyond it? I don't want to do the ground. I don't want to make the ground end exactly where the Parasaurolophus' feet are, because it looked like it's on like the top of, unless it's like on top of a hill or a mountain, which this wouldn't be. In my picture, it's not, at least. If you want to make the dinosaur look like it's on the top of a mountain or a hill, you make the ground end exactly where its feet are. But if it's supposed to be like on like, a regular landscape, a more common landscape, like a swamp or a forest or something, you should make the ground go beyond its feet. So I'm gonna make it go up to about maybe a little bit past the ankles here. Make sure my paint's really wet. I don't want it to dry just yet. All right, here we go. Cool. Great. Excellent. All right, now I'm gonna take some green. Little bit of green, not too much green. Mix my green with my orange a little bit, and I'm gonna make some like, just kind of like with a T-Rex, some like messy foliage here. Foliage is another word for plants. A lot of trees and bushes and stuff. Here we go. And I'm gonna make kind of some blobs here that could be interpreted as some trees in the distance, right? Literally just doing some scribbles with my, I'm using the side of my brush, kind of gives like the illusion of like some bushes and stuff. I'm gonna fill out this part in here underneath its belly. Can't forget about that. All right. There we go. And I'm going to make a couple bushes stick out above the tail in the background too. Don't forget about that. There we go. Cool. Great. Okay. So here's what I have now. And I have like a nice little background, a simple background, nothing too crazy. Okay. Now let's move on to some more detail stuff. Head's not quite dry yet. This was taking a while to dry, isn't it? T-Rex, I don't remember being this wet, but that's okay. All right, let's start with a spot that is dry. Let's do some shading. Now, I think for shading,
I'm gonna use my pencil again. And just like the T-Rex, I can just kind of shade in the bottom parts of the animal. Oh, it's still wet. That's okay. What else can we add while we're waiting for this main coat to dry? Let's see. Let's do the sky. Yeah. I don't think we did a sky last time, did we? So I'm gonna show you a trick. Now, if I wanted to, I could paint the whole sky blue. That's fine. I've done that before. But let's do something else. Let's make it kind of like cloudy. At least I'm gonna do that for mine. If you want to make your whole sky blue, that's okay. You do that. But I'm gonna show you what I'm gonna do. Maybe you'll like it. Maybe you'll want to try it. So I'm gonna mix a little bit of black with a little bit of blue until I get this nice light gray. And instead of making a mostly blue sky with white clouds, I'm gonna have a mostly white sky with gray. And what this is gonna show, or make it look like, is that the sky is like mostly overcast, like a cloudy day. Because here in Maryland right now, it is a cloudy day out. So I'm gonna make it like that. And what that shows, it makes I'm gonna take some a little bit of water and kind of smooth out the top there. There we go. And what that's gonna make it look like behind my Parasaurolophus's head is that though most of the sky is cloudy, and you're seeing like a little bit of the shadow under the clouds. It's kind of cool, right? I don't know about you. A lot of people don't like cloudy days. I know a lot of people don't like them. It makes them feel yucky. I actually kind of like cloudy days sometimes. The sun can be very bright, and I know the sun's important. Plants need it to grow, but I kind of like cloudy days. Sometimes I like to take a walk on like a foggy day or a cloudy day. If you ever look at like a forest or a big open field on a cloudy or foggy day, it's actually really pretty. Some people think it's spooky. I don't think it's spooky. I think it's really pretty. There's my other kind of divot. So again, this sky is supposed to be all clouds. There's like a big cloud. Maybe it's gonna rain soon. Who knows? Maybe this Parasaurolophus is about to get wet. Hope he doesn't mind. But either way, there's clouds. All right. Here we are. Looks pretty cool. Nice. Okay. Oh, and look at the bottom. Look at the ground. Look at the way it's drying out. See, I did a lot of wet stuff, and then I took more wet paint and put it on top, and you can see it's making these, like, they call it blossoming in watercolor. And sometimes it's a bad thing. Sometimes you don't really like it. But with natural scenes, like ground and bushes and earth, stuff that's not supposed to be straight lines anyway, it looks really neat. So it looks like there's moss growing or like a little divot or hills. And I didn't even have to draw any of that. The paint did it all by itself. So if you have a chance, maybe you have an old set of my watercolors. You can get them really cheap at like the toy store. Might have some at home already laying around. Maybe experiment with that a little bit. Might be fun. Just try it. You don't even have to draw a picture. You can just take the colors and just kind of put them on paper and put some water on and experiment. All right. All right, I think our head is pretty much dry. So I'm gonna start doing the shading now. I'm try to go back to this leg here. So my pencil, just like I do with the T-Rex, I'm gonna color in some shading. There we go. All right. I'm gonna go under the feet, the toes. Just like T-Rex, I'm gonna give some like big wide scales. I'm actually going over the paint this time with a pencil. Last time I think I did everything in pencil first, and then I did the paint. This time I did the first layer of paint, then the pencil. Doing a wrinkle under where the knee would be. Some wrinkle on top of the knee. I'm gonna do a big wrinkle. I'm gonna show you here. I'm gonna do a big wrinkle that's gonna go from the armpit to like midway across the thigh. Like kind of like there's like skin kind of draped. Skin's not super wrinkly like an elephant, but there's like a big wrinkle here, like a belly wrinkle. And if you look at animals alive today, especially big reptiles like Komodo dragons or even alligators and crocodiles, sometimes they have something like that there. So it's not out of the question. And then I'm gonna do some lines on the belly. Remember, just like the T-Rex's tail, I'm making curved lines on the belly and on the side and on the tail. And what that's doing, if you remember from our T-Rex drawing, is it's conveying that this dinosaur is round. It kind of has a belly sticking out, the tail's thick from side to side, and it gives the drawing more depth, and it makes it look less flat. It makes it look like you're looking like at a real three-dimensional thing, which is even cooler if you think about it, since no one's ever seen a living dinosaur before. And going over these wrinkles that I made. I can do the shading behind the other arm here. Shading under the tail. Some shading under the belly. The belly would have had shading too, of course. There we go. Under the neck. Now, this can maybe get tricky with the shading with all these wrinkles, because you have to make sure that your shading goes along with the wrinkles. So see, I'm not just kind of shading straight across. I'm kind of going with the wrinkles that I made myself. And I'm letting the wrinkles guide where the shading would be. Now I'm going to shade under the upper jaw where the beak is. I'm going to do some wrinkles around the eye. Because it would have had to have some loose skin there when it blinked. And then finally, underneath our crest. And then our beak is right here. Great. All right. Cool. Okay. Now we have a shaded in Parasaurolophus. Looking good. Doesn't it kind of look like a cranky old man? All that wrinkly skin and that kind of upper lip look. It's not a lip, it's a beak, but it looks like an upper lip, doesn't it? Kind of funny. Okay. All right. Let's put some more colors on this guy. Let's give him some like pattern. Our T-Rex had pattern. Let's give this guy pattern too. All right. I'm gonna take which brush? I'm gonna choose this brush, a more thin brush. I'm gonna mix a nice red, a little bit of green, a little bit more red. All right, that's like a darker brownish red. And I'm going to do a big stripe over the eye. That's going to start here. And I'm not going to make it a clean line. I'm going to kind of make like a wiggly, squiggly line. Because remember that all this skin is wrinkly, right? So the stripe wouldn't look super clean. And then I'm going to make the stripe go all the way down the back. We're at the hips, and it's going to go all the way down to the tail. Whoop. Huh. That. It's kind of cool. Let's put a couple more stripes. And I'm going to make them all going in the same, like, kind of parallel, like racing stripes. The next one is going to start at the base of the crest. It's going to go through this little skin flap thing. It's going to go on the top of the back, all the way down, parallel to the other one. All right. Looking good. Going to make that a little darker here. Kind of fade it out on me. All right. There's our second stripe. All right, let me make more of that color. Okay. I'm going to make another stripe on this, the top, sorry, the top part of the crest. Couldn't see in the camera there.
This one's actually not going to get to the back because it's too high. And then there's going to be another one at the very tip of the crest, little one. Cool. All right, let's make another stripe that starts maybe like halfway down the neck, goes over the shoulder, and then gets really squiggly and zigzaggy. And again, if you want to do a different pattern, you can do a totally different pattern if you want. And now my stripe is going to get like, I'm going to make it curve up to imply that that leg is sticking out a little bit. Because not flat, and then it's going to go back down with the tail. Got to mix more of that brown again. Then this one's going to start like at the armpit, more zigzaggy. Note how messy and zigzaggy my stripe is, right? It's not like a straight line. If you made a straight line, it actually wouldn't look as natural. So a lot of people, like you're used to, like a lot of people when they're coloring, you're always known to, you know, you've always been told, oh, make sure you stay in the lines. But when you're doing your own artwork, sometimes, especially when you're doing something natural, like an animal or a plant, like being doing straight lines all the time isn't necessarily good. There we go. Cool. Okay, that looks neat. That came out pretty cool. And that might be like, even though it can has display going on up here, it still kind of blends in and the stripes kind of break up the animal shape, help it camouflage. And you know, maybe Parasaurolophus, you know, in the springtime, you know, let's say it's the springtime now, right? So let's say this is the springtime and that's when the Parasaurolophus were looking to attract a mate and maybe have babies, right? And that's when the males of a lot of bird species alive today become brightly colored. So maybe Parasaurolophus changed colors during the year, like a lot of birds do. Right now, another little bird called a goldfinch is flying around in my backyard. And during the winter, goldfinch are like brown or gray, but in the springtime, they turn bright yellow. Their brown and gray feathers fall out, and bright yellow feathers grow in. It's like you almost need sunglasses to look at this bird, it's so bright. And then again, when the season when they're having babies and attracting mates is over, they turn brown and gray again. So maybe Parasaurolophus was only bright red during certain parts of the year. Again, like with our T-Rex, last time I said like you can kind of make a story around your piece of art. That's kind of what I'm doing here, right? We have no scientific evidence what color Parasaurolophus was, but I'm making it this color, and here's how I'm going to explain it. So that's pretty fun. Let's color that beak. So I'm going to make the beak like a little bit of like a darker brown so it stands out a little bit more. Okay. So here's my beak. I'm going to paint it in. And I'm just painting right over the red. So when taking the dark brown and painting over the red, when you're working with watercolor, it's not going to completely cover it. So it's going to be kind of like a reddish brown color. Because it's kind of tinted over it. And I'm also going to do the same color for the toenails. Just like I painted T-Rex's nails. Remember I made that like silly joke, but like I work at a nail salon. Here we go. Doing it again. Maybe I should like I make maybe I missed my calling. Maybe my real calling in life was supposed to be like, you know, 70 million years ago, 66 million years ago, depending on the time of the Cretaceous, and I just should have opened a nail salon for all the dinosaurs. They could have come in and I would have painted their nails for them. All right, and lastly, let's do that little eye. All right, and you see some black. A little pupil here. Well, did I even? There you go. Little pupil. There we go. That's much better. Okay, so I painted in the eye, and it kind of stands out a lot better. Okay, cool. All right, so we have a couple minutes left. So the last thing I'm going to do, of course, is I'm going to take that black pen and I'm going to kind of sharpen it up a bit. So I'm going to close up my paints, going to move my water back. Move my paintbrushes out of the way again. Here's my little black pen. All right. And I'm going to just kind of quickly, and again, remember, I'm not going to go over the whole thing. Now, the beak is still wet, so I'm not going to start there. I'll start at the foot this time. I'm going to very gently, I don't need to go over every line, start outlining my dinosaur. Now, I'm not going to outline the background. Like, I'm not going to outline the trees. And the reason why that is because even in real life, the farther away something is, the less detailed it shows. So, like, if you go outside and there's a tree right in front of you, you can see all the detail in it. But if there's a tree, like, 100 feet away behind that tree, you're not going to see all the detail. So I don't want to put a lot of detail into the background that's far away because it wouldn't really look as realistic. Some wrinkles there. The belly. A big plant-eating dinosaur belly. There's the toenail, claw, whatever. Foot. Okay, here's that wrinkle I did on the side of the belly. Some lines on the bottom, some lines here. Here's the shoulder. Elbow. Wrist, front claw, that's kind of like a hoof, back claw, the other back claw, wrist, elbow. I'm going to start doing the back, those tall neural arches. Remember the neural arches, which is the top part of your vertebra. Dinosaurs had them too, so did we. Gonna do my eye, the wrinkles around the eye, the crest, the wavy wrinkles in the crest. Gonna even take the black mark and do a couple wrinkles. I'm not gonna outline all the wrinkles, just some of them. There we go. Nostril. The lower jaw, the ear is right here. The dewlap, remember the dewlap? That's what we call that flappy piece of skin underneath the neck. And a lot of animals, especially reptiles and birds, or birds are actually technically a kind of reptile. So birds and other reptiles, we could say, okay, have dewlaps. Iguanas have them. They're the most famous. The little lizards that you see in the south, especially Florida, called anoles, they have them too. Or anoles. Some people call them anoles. Here's the beak. The beak's not quite dry, but I'm going in there anyway. And there we go. Okay. Oh, no, I forgot my shadow. Whoops. That's okay. It'll be real quick. Get my paints back out. Remember the big shadow we did on the T-Rex? I gotta do that here too, right? So I'm gonna take this medium brush. Gonna mix, remember the colors that we use for our basic ground shadow? That's black with blue, right? Because if you do straight black, it's not gonna look as three-dimensional, not gonna look as realistic. Watery paint. I'm gonna quick paint that shadow. Now, Parasaurolophus wasn't as big and robust as Tyrannosaurus Rex, but still the shadow would have had to be pretty wide. There we go. Okay, cool. There we go. And I'm actually going to use that same shadow color to write my name. I think I told you guys last time, you can write your name. I like to, and a lot of artists, we typically write our name in the lower right corner. So here we go. C-H-R-I-S. And then I'm just going to put my first and my last initial. D. There we go. Okay. And I think we're all done. Let's see. I'll hold it up so you can see the finished piece. Okay. There it is. There's our Parasaurolophus all finished. The bright red and the stripes.
Shadow underneath, looking good. Nice side piece, nice side profile with the cloudy sky. Like, I think I like the colors, the way the colors worked out. We got the like bluish gray and green, brown, and that pop of reddish pink on the head kind of really brings it out. So that's really neat. I missed a question. So let's see. Had teeth kind of like a shark's constantly placed? Yes, exactly. Crocodiles as well have that. And pretty much all reptiles. Yes. Let's see. That was from Shane. And then let's see. Linden says a lot of books show Parasaurolophus wading in water. Oh yeah, that's a great question. We don't really have really any evidence or reason to think that Parasaurolophus was a swimmer. A long time ago, like decades ago, they thought that duck-billed dinosaurs were swimmers. And that's because of the duck-like, the superficially duck-like skull that they had on the beak. Look, they thought we would eat water plants like a duck would. And also, remember I told you about the hadrosaur mummies with the skin? Well, there's one that's actually on display in New York City in the American Museum of Natural History of an Edmontosaurus, where the skin preserved between the fingers, and it looks like it would have had webbed fingers like a or webbed fingers like a duck's foot. But that's not reflective of what the animal would have looked like when it was alive. That's just the mummified skin that kind of dried out and shrink wrapped around the bones. So what it really would have been more like is more fleshy skin with muscle and stuff, and it would have been like a hoof. So these guys were land animals. They weren't amphibious. They weren't swimmers. Like I know in Land Before Time, the famous cartoon Ducky, who's a relative of Parasaurolophus. I think she's a Saurolophus, which is a slightly different duck-billed dinosaur. She's called a swimmer, and she swims a lot. That cartoon was made when they still kind of thought they were good swimmers. Now, duck-billed dinosaurs or hadrosaurs could swim. In fact, most dinosaurs probably could swim, just like most animals alive today can swim. But that doesn't mean that they swam well. So if a duck-billed dinosaur had to get across a river or whatever, it could, just like a horse, right, could swim, or elephants can swim. Most animals alive today can swim, but they're just not really, evolved for it. So to answer your question, Parasaurolophus and hadrosaurs weren't really amphibious dinosaurs, most likely. They were land animals. Yep. And then if you visit Field Station Dinosaurs this later this summer, if we open up, or in the fall, Parasaurolophus is on display there. We have a big model of Parasaurolophus. So hopefully you guys will see it there. And if you followed along, just like last time, please post your drawings in the comments section. We really want to see your artwork. All right. And then lastly, someone, Kimberly, wants to know if I can make a stegosaurus. Maybe that could be our next one. I'd like to make another vote. I think the voting was fun. So yeah, a Baryonyx lost by just a little bit this last time. So maybe we can do Baryonyx versus Stegosaurus. And I know I think Triceratops was still was requested last time, as was Gorgosaurus and Troodon, which I believe has changed its name, by the way, to Stenonicosaurus. Same thing, Troodon and Stenonicosaurus, the same thing. Yeah, we'll see. Let's see what we do. We'll put another poll up, and maybe Stegosaurus will be in that poll, and maybe we can vote on it. If we keep doing this every week, we'll probably eventually see all the dinosaurs that you guys want to see anyway. All right, so it's been fun, and I'll see you again next week, Wednesday at 4 o'clock. Bye bye.